have two major categories of dynamic routing protocols. We have distance vector routing protocols and link state routing protocols. First, let's consider distance vector routing protocols. I remember back in high school, I learned the definition of a vector. I used to think of a vector as an arrow pointing in a direction, but I learned that a vector has both magnitude and direction, and in a sense, distance vector routing protocols, they also have a magnitude and a direction that get associated with a destination network. Our IP routing table learns to get to the 172.16.1.0/24 network, we go in this direction. This is our next hop IP address, or we're going to go out of this interface. That's the direction component, and it also has a magnitude. This magnitude, sometimes we call it a distance. How far is it to this destination network? Or we might call it a metric. It's a relative weighting of how far it is to get to the network via one path versus another path. As a couple of examples of distance vector routing protocols, we have RIP and EIGRP. RIP, or the Routing Information Protocol, the way it works is by using a variant of the Bellman-Ford algorithm. And what we're really saying here is that every router is going to calculate, how far is it? What's the distance to all these other networks that we know about? And then each router tells their neighbors about all these networks that they know. It's a fairly chatty protocol. RIP can do something like this. If I've got 10 routes in my IP routing table and I'm running RIP, every 30 seconds I might be broadcasting out to all of my neighbors, hey, here's a list of the networks I know about. And 30 seconds later I say, hey, here's a list of the networks I know about. That's not very efficient, is it? A lot of people tend to shy away from RIP for one reason, because of its chatty nature and telling its neighbors its full IP routing table every so often. But there is an exception to this. Let's say that you tell me, hey Kevin, here's how you get to the 10.0.0.0/8 network, and I add that to my IP routing table. When I broadcast that out to my neighbors, well, you're my neighbor. I've learned about the 10.0.0.0/8 network you told me, but when I broadcast out my IP routing table to my neighbors, I'm not going to tell you. Why? Because you told me that would be redundant. In other words, I'm not going to send route information back out of an interface if I learn that route information from that interface. That is called the split horizon rule. The split horizon rule again says, if I learn about a network off of one interface, I'm not going to use that interface to broadcast out that network information. And that can help us prevent some routing loops, so that's a good thing. But RIP is not very advanced in the way it calculates the magnitude or the distance to a remote network. Specifically, the metric it uses is hop count. How many routers do I have to transit? Do I have to hop through in order to get to that destination network? One of the downsides of using hop count is we're not considering link speed. We might be going over a very slow link as compared to a much faster link just because it's a fewer number of hops. And also, RIP isn't terribly scalable. We have a maximum hop count of 15 routers that we can transit to get to a destination network. After that, this destination network is considered unreachable. So if RIP had a metric of 16 for a particular network, that would be unreachable from the perspective of RIP. A much more advanced distance vector routing protocol is EIGRP, Enhanced Interior Gateway Routing Protocol. The algorithm it uses to make its calculation is called DUAL, which stands for Diffusing Update Algorithm. Here, the routers are going to form neighborships. They're going to form adjacencies with other EIGRP speaking routers. And initially, they'll exchange their full routing information, but unlike RIP, which broadcasts its entire list of routes every 30 seconds, with EIGRP, we're only going to be sending updates. So it's a lot less chatty than RIP is. But how does DUAL work? We form these neighborships, these adjacencies, and our neighbors are going to tell us how far is it to this destination network from their perspective. They're advertising their metric to us, or they're advertising their distance to this destination network, and it's called the advertised distance. For example, if you tell me that you have a distance of 1 million to get to a particular network, and maybe there's a distance of 2 million for me to get to you, then grand total, my distance to that network is 2 million plus 1 million, it's 3 million. The distance you told me, the distance you advertised to me, is called the advertised distance. But once I add on the distance that it takes me to get to you, that's the feasible distance. And I might learn about different ways of getting to a destination network. And what we're going to do, I'm going to look at my feasible distances, and I'm going to pick the best one. And the best one is going to be called my feasible route. And if I have a backup path with a less attractive metric, well, that's going to be my successor route. And the metric is a lot more advanced than just a hop count. By default, EIGRP is going to consider bandwidth to the destination and delay, the cumulative delay that it takes to go over this link and this link and this link all the way to the destination. And we'll get into the exact formula later on in our studies. But by default, EIGRP is using bandwidth and delay, but it can consider some other things. It can consider the reliability of a link, how loaded a link is. And as kind of a tiebreaker, it can consider the MTU, the maximum transmission unit size. How big can a packet be maximum that we're sending out of an interface? But by default, we're just considering bandwidth and delay. Let's take a look at a couple of examples. Here's an example of using RIP. Notice that R3 is directly connected to the 172.16.1.0/24 network, and it's going to broadcast this out. By the way, RIP version 1 uses broadcast, RIP version 2 uses multicast, and there is another version of RIP, RIP-NG, that's used with IP version 6 networks. Let's pretend we're just talking about version 1 here. R3, it's directly connected to this network. Every 30 seconds, it's going to broadcast out to its neighbors that it is directly connected to this network. Well, R2 sees that broadcast, and R2 then adds an entry to its IP routing table saying, well, if R3 is directly connected, that's just one hop away. I would just have to go through router R3 to get to that network. I'm one hop away from 172.16.1.0/24. And R2 is going to broadcast that out to R1. R1 has now learned about two different ways of getting to this network. R1 says, well, I can get there via two hops. If I go via R2, I would have to go through R2, and then there would be one other hop. That would get me to the network. Or, if I went directly to R3, that would only be one hop away. R1 concludes, I'm going to use R3 to get over to the 172.16.1.0/24 network. It's only one hop away. And if this laptop needs to send traffic to that server, that's the path it's going to use. Simple. However, what if we looked a bit deeper? What if we discovered that the bandwidth between R1 and R3 was a measly 64 kilobits per second? We've got a lot more bandwidth if we went via R2. Yes, it's another hop, but look at the speeds. It would still be much more efficient for us to send traffic via R2 because we've got more bandwidth available to us. There's less chance of congestion. Fortunately, something like EIGRP could take this into account. Let's say that we're using EIGRP now, and R3 says, I'm directly connected to 172.16.1.0/24, and it's going to multicast that information out to its neighbors. And just to make the math easy, let's pretend that R2 says, well, my distance to R3 is 1 million, so my distance to this network of 172.16.1.0/24, it's 1 million. And then R2 is going to advertise that distance out to R1. R1 has now received an advertised distance for this network from two different routers. R1 says, well, if I go via R2, my distance to get to R2 is 2 million. And R2 says, it's 1 million away. 1 million was the advertised distance from R2. My distance to get to R2 is 2 million. We add those up for a grand total of 3 million. That's my feasible distance. But my distance to R3, because of the link speed being so low, is 8 million. My feasible distance via R3 is 8 million. My feasible distance via R2 is 3 million. R1 says, I'm going to use R2 to send a packet to the 172.16.1.0/24 network. And that's how EIGRP works. We've now seen a couple of examples of distance vector routing protocols. Let's now consider link state routing protocols. Here's the way I want you to think of a link state routing protocol. Imagine a router having a map of the network. Literally, instead of just knowing to get to a specific destination network, I need to go to this next hop address, with a map, we know that we're going to go to this router, and then we're going to go to this router. We know the entire path from source to destination, just as if you had a map and you were mapping out a trip, or you had your car's navigation system map out the trip for you. That's what's going on here. We're looking at the entire territory. We're looking at the entire map of the network, and the router is running an algorithm to determine the best way to get from point A to point B. What are some examples of link state routing protocols? The one that we're going to be focusing on in our studies is OSPF, open shortest path first. The algorithm that the router is running is the Dijkstra algorithm, which, by the way, is the same algorithm that's used in your car's navigation system. It's able to assign costs between different nodes in a network, between different points in a map, and it's able to mathematically determine the most cost-efficient way to get from one point on that map to another point on the map. That's what the router does. It says, what's the most cost-efficient way, in terms of bandwidth, to get to this destination network we're trying to reach? And an interesting characteristic of OSPF is that it relies on IP to carry routing information. For many years, OSPF version 2 was widely used. It still is. But OSPF version 2, it relies on IP version 4 to carry routing information. Does that mean that OSPF is not compatible with IP version 6? Not at all. We just have to use a newer version of OSPF. OSPF version 3 will work with IP version 6 networks. But this reliance on IP to carry routing information, that's one of the distinguishing characteristics between OSPF and another popular link state routing protocol, which is ISIS, intermediate system to intermediate system. Like OSPF, ISIS also uses the Dijkstra algorithm, but unlike OSPF, it does not rely on IP to carry routing information. It can route a variety of routable protocols. In fact, when IP version 6 was being adopted by some organizations, they started to use ISIS because OSPF version 2, which they had been using, it relied on IP version 4, and now suddenly they're using IP version 6. Because ISIS does not have that dependence, some companies started using ISIS. But again, remember, we can still use OSPF on an IP version 6 network. We just have to use OSPF version 3. Those are a couple of examples of link state routing protocols. These protocols cause the router to have a map of the network, unlike a distance vector routing protocol, which simply says, to get to a destination network, I'm going to go in this direction. I'm going to go to this next hop device. And in our studies, the link state routing protocol that we're going to be focused on is going to be OSPF.